of course, we got to talk about Alex Ovechkin, yes, and the power play. I mean, how do you even stop the grade eight on the power play? Is that even possible?
Obviously, it's tricky because he scored a ton of goals in his, his career. And the beauty of the Washington power play is that if you take Ovechkin away, they will try other options. But if you're going to kill penalties against Washington, the one thing and first thing you should take away should be
Ovi. The obvious
one-timer.
Ovi in his office.
And you start going historically. Okay, the coaches will say that, but maybe you need some numbers to drive it home. You know how much I like numbers. So our friend Tom Galitti came up with this one. Of the 249 power play goals that he scored on one-timers, 40% of those 249 were from that left circle. In the last 6 years, so as of late, 77 of his last 138 one-timers were scored from the left circle or above. 56% of Ovi's power play goals in the last 6 years are one-timers from up there. Okay, so there's your numbers. So we know the first option we need to take away is Ovi and his shot. So first option is maybe get your stick out there. If you can block the pass, get it. If not, then the defenseman, who is Ryan Johansson spotlighted, has to stay in that green line. You have to, because now there's no stick in the lane. Johansson gets focused on the puck. And what's in the green line, Jackie? Nothing.
Nothing.
And that's a bad situation for the goaltender.
Even when you know it's coming.
Doesn't matter because he shoots it so well. Yeah. Doesn't matter. Same situation. Okay, now you're going to try to block. You have maybe a stick in the passing lane or this time a body in the shooting lane. Okay,
once again,
maybe the stick's there a little bit. Okay, now they both collapse. Now, a lot of teams kill penalties this way, but against the Capitals, I think you have to slide the lower guy back into that green lane, Colton Sissons, because you'll take John Carlson's shot over Ovechkin's.
Right.
Now, it's easy to say, hard to do, as Alex Ovechkin, probably by the end of next year, will be the all-time greatest power play goal scorer in the history of the league. But you can see why, if you just get off your mark a little bit, if you get sucked into a play that's not there, if you get drawn to the middle of the ice, which is where you're often told to go when you kill penalties, collapse to the middle, layer up on your shot blocks, then you give Ovi that clean lane. 56% of his one-timer goals in the last 6 years have come from right in that spot. So you're going to have to change for Washington how you kill penalties and focus on Ovechkin. I'm sure they heard it in the power play, in the penalty kill meeting.
Yeah, of course.
But you just kind of get out there and your instincts take over. You're trying to help. You're trying to get to the right spot. When you just have to know, okay, that's my guy. I have to, at all times, just me and you. I'm going to stay in line with you. I work the angles the other way. But no matter what, and it's a miserable place to play. I've been there. When that guy's going to shoot the puck.
Okay, you mean you don't want to stand in front of an Alex Ovechkin one-timer?
I mean, I don't know if anyone does. And you know if you're going to be out there, you have to hang in there and say, okay, I hope the guys around him don't let him shoot it. But if they do, I'm that terrible 20 feet away. I'm going to turn, and I'm going to hope it hits me.
Yeah, because against the guy who's won the hardest shot competition.
Yeah, I mean, he can zip it. And the goalie knows it's coming, and it doesn't matter anyways. But it was just a great example of what Washington does well, but just how Nashville was really close to being the right spot. But against Ovi and that one-timer, who scores there for so often, close is not good enough. You have to be in the right exact position to be effective killing penalties against him.
How many goals do you think Ovi can get in his career? Like, how close do you think he can get to Gretzky's record?
If he wants to chase it, he'll pass Gretz.
You think so?
If he wants to play
long enough. If he's, like, dedicated to that goal.
If he wants to play to that, to get to that, no pun intended, goal of passing Wayne Gretzky, I think he's got to go about 6 more years, about 40 a year.
Yeah, I mean, he can hit 700 this year.
I mean, the key, I think, for him is he's got to go about 3 more years of getting close to 50.
Right, like he has to take the bulk of it now.
He's got to get the 50, right, which I don't know why we would suggest he wouldn't.
He almost got 50 last year.
Yes.
Yes.
What he does.
So, it is certainly.
Don't bet against Ovi scoring goals.
No, you can't do that. One of the best of all time. All right, how about the new look Jets? Mm-hmm. Apparently they can win without their entire blue line from last year. Because they win again last night. It came against the Wild. Tough night for Minnesota.
It was Patrick Laine dancing. He is leading the league in scoring right now. And he's got a ton of assists. And he's
looking like
well.
The player everyone thought he was.
And sometimes, not for long stretches, Jackie, but for some short stretches, when a lot of your roster's out of the lineup, you can have that bumping effect of everyone coming together knowing that we're in trouble. If we play at all loose, we're in trouble. If we don't support our guys, if we'd have bad turnovers, we're in trouble.
And not just in trouble, probably like embarrassed in their situation.
Sure, absolutely. And maybe big picture in trouble because that central division will be tough and you can't fall too far behind. So I think maybe a little bit more attention being paid by the collective group to support some of the younger names on defense, but good for them, because I think a lot of people saw their defensive roster and the names that are playing big minutes for Winnipeg and think, I don't know how they're going to compete, but they score a lot, Hellebuck plays well, and they get support from their forwards, and they can.
And they take advantage of some mistakes by the Minnesota Wild as well. A rough night for them.
Yeah, so you think about Minnesota, they have to play good defensively. They have been one of the best defensive teams in the league the last few years. All their metrics, the shots given up, scoring chances, high danger chances, all those plays have been really good. And I watched the game against Winnipeg, and I see breakdowns for the Minnesota Wild defensively. That can't happen. So here's the first goal for Winnipeg. Okay, so one-on-ones all around here, okay? So there's, first of all, there's five Devils, only four Jets in the picture, only three that are low. Okay, so
Minnesota Wild.
So Luke Cunning gets caught on the wrong side of the puck chasing when his man is Blake Wheeler. You just can't do that. Brodin and Spurgeon had identified. Cunning gets overexcited. He loses his man. It's in the net. Again, 4-on-2 for the Jets against the Wild. So these defensemen have to gap up. You got back pressure. That means you get closer to them. Only one guy can score here. It's Patrick Laine. Three guys can pick off this pass. Their sticks are all in the air. No one's going to get a piece of that puck, and all of a sudden, a 2-on-4 is a Laine one-timer to the back of the net. That's just not good enough for good defensive players that are out there. Last one here, it's a 2-on-1.5.
I like
once
that.
Brodin goes down to slide. Now he's in trouble because he slides right out of the play. So what was a 2-on-2 ends up being back being another 2-on-1. So Jared Spurgeon plays it pretty right, but because Brodin slides right out of the picture, now Spurgeon's on his knees trying to fish for a puck. It ends up over on an open man, and it's in the net.
Why do defensemen slide?
Well,
because we see it a lot, so yes. I assume it's something that they can do successfully.
Timing's everything, because it's harder to sauce a puck over
right.
a sliding body than it is to pass it underneath the triangle of a stick or even to flip it over his blade.
Okay.
But you have to know, that was Josh Morrissey who had the nice little pullback as Brodin slid right by. But timing, spacing has to all be taken into consideration, because if you don't do it right and they're able to stop on it, then you slide right on by, and the guy basically takes a breakaway, which is what happened to Brodin. So those are good players. I saw Suter out there. I saw Spurgeon. I saw Brodin, Dumba. Good defensive players making mistakes. That cost them. They have to tighten up. They're not scoring a ton of goals right now, so they got to get better defensively. Can't make big-time mistakes. Hockey is a game of mistakes. Everyone makes them all the time, but you can't have big ones in the wrong spots against the wrong players. Last night against the Jets, the Wild did.
And we always say at this time of year, oh, it's early. But, like, early goes away pretty quick. And then all of a sudden, it's December, and you're like, uh-oh.
You know, it's very hard to make up 8 points in the NHL.
It's
very hard. Even in 70 games, it's hard, because you're going to have to leap over eight teams who all will get points at the same time.
You have to play exceptionally well.
All the rest of it, and you completely correct that it's early. But as Yogi Berra said, it's getting late awfully early. So,
oh, nice. I like that. Who doesn't love a Yogi quote once in a while? And we are fortunate enough to have Bo Horvat join us here on NHL Now on a Friday, too, ending the week strong with a strong guest. Thanks for joining us, Bo. We appreciate it. Congratulations on the captaincy. Did you have a feeling that this was in the cards for you?
We did.
A few years ago. I was going to say if you take yourself back, did you ever think that this would be in the cards for you?
I'd be lying if there was no way. Honestly, obviously try to be the best leader you can and try to, play hard on and off the ice. And never in a million years, I think, I'd be a captain of an NHL team, let alone a Canadian franchise and an unbelievable hockey market like Vancouver. So I'm really, really humbled to be in that position right now.
It is a big deal, Bo. I don't think people around maybe North America can appreciate how big of a deal it is in a market like Vancouver that has as much attention, the fan base that you do. What was it like to experience that, not just for yourself, but we also saw shots of your family during the ceremony, and there were some emotions there. What kind of conversations have you had with them going through this process?
Yeah, it was unbelievable to have them there, honestly. Everybody about it, kind of when I heard, so everybody could get out here. And as soon as I told them, everybody booked their flights and was out here, it's a drop of a hat. So to have everybody out here and share that special moment with me, and it was, couldn't ask for anything better.
Bo, you played with a lot of great leaders going back to your time in junior in the OHL, even with London, a great franchise. But coming into the Canucks, a proud franchise, Henrik Daniel, who are some of the people and how did some of those people specifically kind of shape you and maybe have a positive influence on you now being ready for the captaincy?
No, I mean, I can't give enough credit to Hank and Danny and everything they've done for me and the organization and the community and obviously, you know, all the stuff around the Vancouver Canucks organization. Just seeing what they did on a daily, daily basis and how they carried themselves on and off the ice. I tell this to everybody and how I don't think I've ever seen them have a bad day. You know, we could have lost 10-1 or won 10-1 or they would have been the exact same people. And no, I think that's the biggest thing I took away from them is how positive they were on a daily basis.
You've been in this league now for 6 seasons, all in Vancouver. You got Henrik Sedin saying that he's watched you grow into the man that you are now. When you look at the last 6 years, what have you learned about yourself through 6 seasons in the NHL, and how have you changed as a person?
Obviously, I think I've gotten mentally stronger over these last years. Obviously, having success, in my first year, and then making the playoffs, and then not making it for the next four here. It's been tough going, but at the same time, I think it's made me a better player, a stronger player, and obviously, knowing that I can go through this and still, still be mentally strong through it. I think it's just going to make me better and make our team better.
Bo, some NHL teams don't have captains. Yours does now, once again. What's the most important job of a captain in today's NHL?
I think that positivity is the biggest thing. You know, you can't get down on yourself. You can't get down on your teammates because I think, obviously guys look up to you and guys are watching you. And I think you have to be at the top of your game every single night. If you're going to be at the top of your game, guys are going to follow. So to be positive and just the work ethic is a huge thing too. Leading by example is, I would say, the biggest thing here.
What can you tell us about your head coach, Travis Green? I mean, he has done such a good job with this team. I know Johnny played with him, so he's just laughing at the mention of Travis Green. But what is he like as a coach, and what is his message to you guys heading into this new season? Because it's still young.
Yeah, Green has been awesome. I really like Greener as a coach. He's understandable and wants guys to talk to him, and he wants to talk to different guys and get their opinions because he's been there. He's played the game. And he knows what it takes to be in the NHL. And obviously he likes guys that are going to go to war for him and likes guys that are going to, do whatever it takes to win and have that drive to want to get better and love to win and love to play the game. So, it's something that he thrives on is hard work and will to win. So I think a lot of guys in our room have that, so it should be good.
Well, clearly he thinks you're going to go to war for him night in and night out because you are now rocking the sea out in Vancouver. We're going to let you go. I have to ask you one more quick one. Can you tell the Sedins apart?
I can. Yes, they don't even look the same for me anymore.
Really?
Boy.
Okay.
Boy.
All right. Nice. I'll take
it. They respect them so much.
Attention to detail. Attention to detail. I love it.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, listen, thanks again. Congratulations on the honor of being named an NHL captain, and best of luck the rest of the way this season.
Perfect. Thanks for having me, guys.
All right, Bo Horvat and the
Good
Canucks, by the
That's
way.
Sweet.
I mean,
Good
it
choice.
Just seems like
great
a very
choice.
Great dude. And we can't have you on this show, Weeksy, without talking about some of the saves he made the other night, including one that looks like it could compete for save of the year all year.
Should.
Yeah, here's what's crazy, right? Like, he could be playing college hockey right now.
Mm-hmm.
Could be NCAA college hockey player. Could be playing
like a junior in college.
A junior in college right now. I mean, it could be an overager at season's end in junior.
Mm-hmm.
So to come out of Everett last year being his first year, coming out of WHL, come to the NHL, everybody had said so much about him. I had heard so much about him. I talked to his agent, Alan Waugh, about him.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember Claude Giroux saying he's got some Carey Price in him. I was like, hold on.
Hey, wait a minute.
Hold on a second, G.
You can't just toss that out.
You can't just toss that out.
No.
You know what I mean?
But he does.
But he does. And you know what's funny is Johnny told me about Henrik Lundqvist before. Before Lundqvist came over, I'm like, Johnny, are you serious? He's like, no, I'm telling you. He's like,
he's
no,
legit.
I'm saying he's legit. And we've seen what he's gone on to do, become a Hall of Famer. It's early, but I'm going to tell you so far, Carter Hart, for me, for him to be doing what he's doing is beyond exceptional and is so rare, and it defies convention. And everybody talks about hockey sense for players, which they should. Now, watch the Devils. That's Gusev, option number one on the left of your screen, highlighted in yellow. He can shoot, so he's got to honor the shot, the short side, does Carter Hart. Now, he can bump it back up to option number two. Jack Hughes can catch and rip that, right? He can shoot that as a 1T. That's option number two. So he looks over to option number three. So he freezes Hart. Hart has to honor him. And then he comes all the way over and makes this incredible save, which is so hard to fathom because those were literally the three options that he was facing. And to get the extension, not only with the feet and the splits, here's what Hart's seeing from his perspective, okay? So he's got to lock on to Gusev. Why, yep. Johnny? You're a righty. You can't give that up.
No, go right off your ear in the back of the net if you wanted.
Totally.
This is a totally dangerous spot. He's got to respect Jack Hughes, of course. And Hughes even sells this shot with the extra stick handle. And then he's got to track it, Kevin.
Yeah.
This is what's so impressive. He doesn't just get over there and hit his glove. He's eyeballing that thing right into his mitts.
True.
Which is amazing, just in time. And the other part about it, Weeks, you can appreciate this. Mm. That is as athletic, as explosive a move as he will have to make almost the whole year.
Sure.
And he looked very comfortable.
Like absolutely.
He wasn't rushing.
Yeah.
He looked like he was just had time. I'm going to make a push. I'm going to make another push. I'm going to get there.
Right.
Even though he's going as hard as he can post to post. And yet he still makes it look smooth and under control. And that's a little bit of Carey Price. You rarely see them look like they're hurrying to get to a spot, even though he's in a hurry.
Exactly. And a wide open 4x6 for Taylor Hall, who's an MVP. And what's crazy about that is everybody plays a game, regardless of your position, D, forward, goalie, whatever, at their own cadence.
Mm-hmm.
But for him to play at a cadence that's as elegant and smooth,
yeah,
as you're saying, hence the Carey Price. So a lot of patience, but you have to be able to trust yourself, trust your skills, trust your instincts, and your reads have to be on point. And all those things came through. Philadelphia Flyers are very fortunate, man. This guy's a stud.
Look, 20 years they've been looking for this guy?
Yeah, exactly.
Tell you what, Carter Hart keeps playing like the way he has been to start the season. The Flyers could be looking at heading back to the postseason. You talk about how well he tracks pucks, tracks options, all this stuff. Mm-hmm. We mentioned that as a save of the year candidate. Well, we're tracking saves of the year and goals of the year. Of course we are.
Okay.
So that's candidate number one for
that's
the
good
week,
one.
Right?
Yes. Start. Yes.
Candidate number one.
What do we got?
How about Sergei Bobrovsky, your boy out in Florida, with a save of his own, on also an MVP, Nikita Kucherov.
Incredible.
Very similar, right?
Very similar. Looked like Altuve on this one, by the way. But
nice.
Very similar in the way he gets over there, but even more explosive, a little less elegant, mm-hmm, but equally as impressive. One of the best in the business. Great save by him there.
Crazy how similar those two saves are. All right,
how about this one? No, no, no. He bit on the shot fake, too. He was down on his knees. Oh, nightmare material for Donato. Weeksy.
I love this.
This hurts if you're the forward.
I love that one because you know what? Donato thought that was a wide open
wide
cage.
Open.
It's like I left you back there.
I got
it. And then keep it on the edge of the glove for good measure.
All right,
hold that.
Fourth nominee, boys, Doobie.
Oh, old school. This is Weeksy when he's 7 years old on the road. Two-pad stack, Phil Ranford sends a tip of the cap over to Devin Dubnyk.
That's exactly what I was going to say. You know, this is Ranford-esque. Billy Ranford, are you watching this in L.A.? You should be, because that vintage Billy Ranford with the Oilers. What a save by Devin Dubnyk. I love
Swag
that.
Swag points, right, Johnny? Swag points on
that one.
That's
why I like Bobrovsky.
All right.
He caught it.
Very much.
Yes,
very much
that's
so.
Right. All right, we want to know what you guys at home think, so head to Twitter and the NHL Network account and look at the candidates. Let us know which one you would choose for save of the week. We're going to track it each and every week. Then we're going to put the winner of the month up against the next winner, yada, yada, yada.
I like where
and
you're
have
going,
a king at the end of the season for save of the year. We'll reveal the results of this poll later in the show and get the picks from the guys. So think about it, guys. Let it marinate.
All right.
For save of the week. And we'll take a look at our candidates for goal of the week. We got to start with this guy right here.
He's got the
here.
Flow of the
he's,
week
he's
right
missing
now.
Some teeth.
The kale's nice.
But.
Are you kidding me?
The kale's nice.
One-handed, on his way down.
Fighting off a defender.
And it's actually easier to take one-handed shots on your backhand. He goes forehand.
Yes.
And somehow elevates. Are you kidding me?
That's incredible.
You could give no defender, no goalie, and just say, hey, get this in the air. And I don't know if anyone in the league could do it. That was unreal by Blake Coleman. Travis Konechny, he's breaking Konechny's.
Oh.
And Duncan Keith over in Prague, little toe drag, quick backhand ripper over Corey Crawford.
Smooth too, all in motion.
See, Duncan Keith gets his knees together trying to block it, and then you're done. Konechny signs that contract a couple days into camp.
Konechny four. Konechny five.
Is
all right, how about this one for the other night? Big rivalry night between the Flames and the Kings.
Matthew Tkachuk.
How about Tkachuk?
No big deal, bring it back and put it home. And back, couple this in with the whole scene and the game and the trailing and doubting
and
all
of it. We need to have you guys in a little box in the corner watching.
But just, understood. He's playing keep up over here, like as a soccer ball, back towards himself and then dumps it in. That was also very nice.
And Mika.
This is just pretty.
Oh, the passing?
Nice passing.
But this is pretty. This gets style points. And Jackie, you know I always give extra for style points.
Yes, you have to.
Poor Ron Hainsey.
And he's back in Ottawa, too.
He's spinning like a top.
Even Mika's response, he's like, oof, that was spicy.
Wow. But hey, back in Ottawa, restart his career. He's been good against them, 7 goals.
Put up another four-pointer against them.
Yes. And, of course, we want your opinions on the goal of the week as well. So, again, head to Twitter. Let us know which one is the best goal. And, again, guys, the fans weigh in. Yes. You guys make the ultimate call at the end of the show about
what we still want to hear.
Let me know. So, you'll influence my opinion.
Yeah. If you're going to influence Johnny, you got to give him reasons. I will tell you that. You can't just say, like, Blake Coleman.
Yeah, just throw it out there.
And no, you got to give
mop it up looking for Zion.
Exactly.
And work that.
Exactly. All right. Time for a break. Air Force and Notre Dame begin their college hockey season tonight and will face off again on Sunday in a game you can see right here on NHL Network. It is their first meeting since 2006. And joining us now is the associate head coach of Notre Dame, Andy Slaggart. Andy, welcome to the show. You must be excited. First game tonight. It's a big deal. What are you expecting from the squad this year?
Yeah, we're very excited about the game to get the season started. We're expecting, a lot of big things. This is a group that works extremely hard, and that's saying something for our program. I think we have a reputation of having hardworking, honest hockey teams, and for this group to stand out in among that company is pretty special.
Andy, you also have a bit of a pipeline to the NHL. You have 7 current Notre Dame players on NHL rosters. What is it about the program at Notre Dame that produces so many NHLers?
Well, I think we really pride ourselves on development, and it's not, we have a few first rounders like Riley Sheehan, Ian Cole and Kyle Palmieri, but the majority of our players that make it to the NHL are mid to late round picks that we really work hard with. And obviously the longer they stay, the more time they have to develop in college. And like Brian Rust stayed 4 years, Riley Sheehan and Anders Lee and Ian Cole, they all stayed 3 years. So and they are all in position to, to get their degrees as well.
Well, according to the experts, Andy, heading into this season, this is a top 10 ranked team. What do you think is this particular roster's biggest strength?
Well, I would say that we're strong in net. Having Cale Morris come back for his senior year is something that we were very excited about. And the senior class in general, I think, to have a strong senior class in college hockey really can set the tone for the whole season.
Andy, forget about the seniors. Let's talk about the sophomores. Your son, Graham, plays for you there. Now, I know parent-child dynamics on the sports field can be tough, but at a college level, are you harder on him? What's it like to coach him?
Well, to be honest with you, we kind of ignore each other. our associate head coach, Paul Pooley, he spends a lot of time with Graham, obviously Coach Jackson, and our volunteer coach, Max Mobley last year and Kyle Lawson this year, that they kind of make sure that he gets the attention that he needs and the reinforcement. And I think it works out well. Surprisingly, we don't talk a lot of hockey away from the rink other than about NHL games and friends and family that are playing in different places and things like that. But we both, I think, need a break when we're home or when we're having dinner. So, Notre Dame hockey is not a topic of conversation, but hockey itself is kind of woven throughout our lives. So we talk a lot about different friends and family that are playing.
But does he ever on the bench just turn around and say, "Dad, I got it"?
No, we haven't had that. We haven't had that happen just yet.
Oh, that's so funny. Listen, Johnny was talking in the meeting. Johnny played college hockey as well, about when he was playing and playing at Notre Dame and sort of
it's a long way from where it is now.
Yeah. So back then there was fencing going on just beside the rink and all this other stuff. Where's the hockey program at this point at Notre Dame, which is, by most people's standards, considered like a football school?
Yeah, well, I think that, I remember, coaching against Mike, and they had some really good teams at Bowling Green, and that was a terrifically difficult place to go in and play. But, we've had a major facility upgrade. We play in the Compton Family Ice Arena now, which is one of the premier facilities, not just in college hockey, but in all of hockey across the world. So that obviously has been a major plus. When Coach Poulin handed the reins over to Coach Jackson, we were able to, take some steps competitively, win some conference championships, consistently make it to the NCAA tournament. And I think what was the biggest step for us was probably our first Frozen Four in Denver. When we made it to the Frozen Four, beat Michigan in the semifinal and played in the championship game. Obviously that's still a goal for us that we haven't achieved yet for our program is the national championship, and that's what we're striving for every year.
I got to ask you about something you just mentioned, remembering Johnny when he was with Bowling Green. What was Johnny like as a college kid? Do you remember anything specifically about him?
A long time ago, we'll see.
I remember that he was a big, strong, up and down winger that we had trouble containing down low.
Oh, wow. There you go, Johnny. I like that. A few compliments for you on a Friday.
He'd be a good recruiter. I'd want to come play for him. You're rating the truth carefully.
Love it. Well, listen, Andy, thanks for the time. We appreciate it. We know you got a big game tonight, and we look forward to watching your second game this Sunday right here on NHL Network.
Sounds great. Thanks for having me.
Thursday, but we're throwing it back anyway. On this day in 1984, Mario Lemieux himself, in his first game on his first shift and his first shot, scores. He was pretty good.
How about that for foreshadowing?
Taste of what's to come for the next 15 years.
Right?
Here's some more history with Dave Stubbs.
Welcome to History Lessons, our weekly walk back into the past of the NHL. Enjoyed being with you last season here on NHL Now, and I look forward to being with you this year to again look back into some of the great events and names of the NHL's past. I'm a year older, but then so too is the league, and so too is the greatest game on earth, so all's good. This week we celebrate the 49th anniversary of the first game coached by one of the best the game has ever seen. On October 10, 1970, Al Arbor stepped behind the bench of the St. Louis Blues for his first game as an NHL coach. Arbor was a 3-1 winner over the New York Rangers that night on home ice, Christian Bortolo scoring twice and Red Berenson once, Jean Rattel replying for the Rangers. Arbor would coach 107 games over three seasons for the Blues, but of course he'd make bigger headlines on Long Island over two decades, coaching an even 1,500 regular season games for the Islanders. And Al was a champion and then some, guiding the Islanders to four consecutive Stanley Cup championships from 1980 to 83. The first ended the Montreal Canadiens' run of four straight from 1976 to 79. Arbor coached through the 1993-94 season, but returned for one more game in 2007-08 to give him that round number. That was at the request of then-coach Ted Nolan, and Arbor made the best of number 1500 on that emotional November 3rd, 2007. It was a 3-2 come-from-behind win over the Pittsburgh Penguins. The Islanders raised a banner post-game to honor the beloved coach who extended his NHL record that night with 740 career regular season wins with one team. Arbor would retire with 782 victories in 1,607 regular season games. That body of work ranked him number three all-time on the NHL's list for games coached, behind Scotty Bowman's 2,141 and Joel Quenneville's 1,638. This month, Islanders coach Barry Trotz passed Arbor for that number three spot with his 1,608th game coached. "It's pretty cool to be with the Islanders," Trotz said of reaching the milestone with New York. "I have nothing but respect for Al." The same could be said for everyone in the game. Arbor died in 2015 at the age of 82, remembered not just for his coaching excellence, but for his steady play as a stay-at-home, dependable defenseman. On the blue line, Al won the Stanley Cup four times, with Detroit in 1954, Chicago in 1961, and Toronto in 1962 and 1964. Arbor was universally admired by teammates, his players, opponents, and fellow coaches alike, inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame as a builder in 1996. We remember Al fondly this week on the anniversary of his first game and his first win as a coach. See you here again next week for another look back into a milestone event in the NHL and to another great name in the history of the game.
I love Dave Stubbs. All right. Okay, let's talk goalie masks. We're sitting down for a reason, because we're going to dive deep into one subject, and that is the goalie mask. So where do you want to start? Because this has become a real style thing for a lot of guys doing different things. Vazzy?
Yeah, I love Vazzy. Yeah, I love it. I love Vasilevsky's, the creativity on it. And he's the big cat, so he's got a snarling big cat on the top. He
like a saber-toothed tiger? What's he got up there?
Absolutely.
Something like that?
Yeah, Siberian tiger.
Siberian,
how about that?
Ah, well played.
You right?
Yeah, okay, I can take that.
Nice elements. Some of the Russian-type font with lightning spelt out. Some of the Russian eagles in the
eagle
back.
There, yeah.
Sweet, man. The 88 chrome on the chin. His painter did an outstanding job. Randy Vezina Trophy winner, too. You know what else was sweet about his mask and the base of it? The Hockey Fights Cancer one he had last year.
That was good.
That was incredible, right. Too. Nice style. Hey, we played in Tampa. Nice, you got to have a little flavor
down
there.
And it's great because it's a chance for goalies to show a little personality.
Exactly.
What's important to them, what kind of guys they are, what motivates them. So, yeah, it's not bad.
Nicely said, Johnny. We're going to mark that. I like that.
I forgot that you guys played together in Tampa. We might have to get into that a little bit later. But for now, we'll stick with the masks. How about Carter Hutton?
This is, for me, the best mask in the NHL right now. You're going to ask me why?
Why?
The simplicity. I love the simplicity of it, but it's clean and it's old school, new school, right? So it's kind of a take on what Ryan Miller had in their organization during his tenure with them. But the horns in gold, the eyes in the red. Yeah, it's a bison head, buffalo head. It's awesome. And then the saber, the handle of the saber is on the left side and right side of the mask. It's just so clean. It's vintage, old school, new school, the best of both.
I like safety first. He's got the throat guard.
Ah.
I mean, it's not stylistic. That's why I wouldn't wear one, probably. I didn't wear a visor. But I'm like, if I was a goalie, how do you not wear the little dangler? You got to wear it to protect yourself.
Dangler. Because that's the technical term, right?
I think that is what it's called when you buy one.
Yeah.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah, dangler.
I like that. Okay. Yeah. How about the King? Henrik Lundqvist.
I mean, what else do we expect? We know that it's going to be sweet. We know that it always looks clean, just like he does.
Oh, I like that
together.
A lot.
Yeah, it's sharp.
It's awesome. And you know what? Something that people don't know, Dave Art over in Sweden, outstanding, who does an amazing job, Dave Gunnarsson, and who did Hanks, of course, going back to his time when, Johnny, you would have played against him in the Swedish Elite League. But it's kind of a tie-in between his Frölunda, which you would have known that mask that he had with all the feathers, the Indian headdress feathers from his team in Sweden, his club team, to kind of incorporating that into the Ranger design. So I think that's sharp.
I like the white on there. Like, not quite as much red, just kind of the blue and white. And, of course, you have the iconic New York Statue of Liberty, whatever it is, the skyline to work with as well. So
I like
the white
that
backdrop's nice.
Yeah. And when your nickname's the King, I mean, you can also throw some crowns.
Of course.
I like
that. Put some rubies up there, bro.
It was very clean. It was very simple. And it was, like, beautiful in its simplicity, actually. I really liked that one.
Well said.
How about
like Hank himself.
Right,
I've given love to John Gibson this week. You've given love to John Gibson this week. It is your turn, Weeksy, to give some love to John Gibson.
I love Gibby. I love Gibby's game. I love everything about him. I think his mask is awesome. Dave Art did an outstanding job on this one because there's some dimensions to it, and I like those dimensions. You're able to see them up close. Nice job by our team. But you can see those dimensions in terms of the different kind of composition of paint that he went with here. So some phantom ducks and the old school logo, which I
like
love.
Starlight, Star Bright.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly. The ducks down there.
Exactly, right?
You find the Big Dipper in there. No,
maybe.
I see the duck head.
California Nights.
Why
you know what I'm saying? Chilling
Clear
Newport
skies.
Beach.
That's it.
With a little vino.
Big Dipper, a little
Why not?
Dipper. How about Ryan Miller?
Ryan Miller's are always clean. This is awesome. The Buffalo ones were great. All of them have been great. But this is a ducks version kind of on that Buffalo one that he had before. But again, that white base, it just looks so smooth, man. And it's kind of an angry-looking, more traditional duck, but I love it.
My question for Ryan Miller, for 15 years since I've seen him, is every time he pops his mask off, it sits askew
tilted, like a
on
Kango.
His head.
He walks it like a Kango.
Like Daddy Kane old school,
yeah,
just kind of off to one
it
side.
Is.
And every time I see him, I'm like, what is with your helmet that it never sits like
it's flavor.
Flat?
It's a little flavor.
I like it.
From Lansing.
If it's intentional, that's impressive.
Yeah. It is, though, true, because he has the one strap
undone.
And it's kind of over here like this a little bit.
I like that we're getting it. We're getting a demo
like
right now.
Like he has a ghetto blaster on the side of his head.
And for 15 years, I've been wondering. Yeah. So there you go.
That's fair. That's a good observation by you.
All right. How about Corey Crawford in Chi-Town?
I mean, Corey Crawford, man, his setups from his pads to his masks are always top-notch. This is amazing. I mean, this is – the Blackhawks arguably have the best uniform in sports, certainly in the top five of all sports in the world. There's so much to work with, and I love the fact that they have the green in the headdress and the multicolors in the headdress, but this current iteration of the kind of black-based gear to tie in with the mask, all the outdoor games they played, his gear always looks incredible.
That's just it. He's willing to go. I don't know if there's a goalie thing or it's a shooter intimidation thing, but he goes to the black base stuff,
it's
and
awesome.
It always looks good. I don't know if it's effective as far as, like, fooling shooters.
Right.
But it looks good.
Yeah.
So I like it.
Yeah, I think
all
it's
right.
sweet.
Well, obviously, like, you're packing some heat here.
Yeah,
you
a little
got
bit.
Something. So, little like,
show
you got to show the people the goods.
Yeah, a little show and tell. You know what? There's no scratch and sniff, but we might get into
Except
that
Dave
in a
Art.
Second.
Dave Art
We might get
well.
Into that in a second.
Because Dave Art as well?
Of course. Dave Art did mine my last 7 years. I'll start with Greg Harrison, the best mask maker that was ever around. Him and Lefebvre Lefebvre made the ones and still does, really, for a lot of Quebecers. Correct.
Yes.
Correct. And Greg Harrison was the best. You know, Cat, everybody had Greg Harrison. But I ended up transitioning to Dave Art. This is my Devils one. So.
And let's just, can we get a real tight close-up of this? Game used. Look at the dents and the divots on the, where are we at here? He's got dents on the front. Puck marks. That's a puck mark.
Yeah, that's better than your brain.
Yeah.
You know?
But
you take that.
That caught you square.
It caught me square. Yeah, good eye by you. So, yeah, I've got, you know, my kind of motif was Black Panther, so I had those on here before the movie even came out, or the current movie, I should say. And the little devil horns in the front, which is pretty cool. The Barbados trident, since my parents are from Barbados, the Barbados flag on the back. Number 40, which isn't really my number.
I never knew the trident was Barbados.
Yeah, yeah,
I never knew what that was down there.
The middle of the flag.
Nice. Yeah.
And a little CN Tower for Toronto.
Oh, right from the team.
Oh, wait, let me see.
You know, our hometown.
Okay, well, yes, of course. I like that. Nice touch.
You're going to ask me to put it on. I'm already hot just
trying to put it on. He doesn't want to put it on. The real reason is
I'm not
the on here. He said it smells.
I could smell it the second you took it out of the
bag. Come on, Johnny. Don't. But it's true. You definitely can.
As if my gear smelled. What?
No, no, you definitely do. I'm just horsing around.
I wouldn't even.
It smells like hockey.
Yeah, it smells like hockey.
It smells like hockey.
So that just brought me back to like 12 years old.
Johnny, you want a little sample?
No, I'm well aware of what that smells
like. It smells like hockey.
It's like, I don't need to smell this. All right. We've been doing this thing this year on NHL Now Oct, where we kind of get into some stories when we have players on the show.
Sure.
Both of you guys, former players, obviously turned analysts. You guys played together in Tampa.
Yeah.
So I want some stories from you two about your short time. About your short time together with the Bolts.
If that's the case.
Well, for starters, Weeksy and I have known each other since we were probably 11 and 12 years old. We went to neighboring high schools in
Younger,
Toronto.
Younger, bro. Don't jack up the math.
Wait, so your parents know each other?
Our dads are buddies. Every time I see Carl, he's like, hey, how's Ron?
Yeah.
They go to the Tim Hortons coffee shop.
And oh, my gosh. Of course they catch up at Tim Hortons.
Where have you been?
It's so Canadian.
Dads that grew up together watching their kids play. So they would cross paths, you know, growing up as minor hockey players. Then again, even in the NHL, we would cross paths when Kev's team would play in Toronto. My dad would be at the game or whatever it might be. So, yeah, we got a lot of history, Kevin and I. And then we were fortunate enough to play in Tampa together. So
we had a lot of fun.
Yeah, so I brought one of the Kevin. Every time I think of Kevin.
Oh, yes.
That's yours.
Oh, but, Jack, I love the tease that I love what this leads to. What do we got here?
He was way ahead of his time. What did you carry everywhere you went?
The bag of beauty. It's here, too.
The bag of beauty.
I love it.
It's got some different components.
You still have
the mask
on. It's amazing.
This is way before anyone knew anything about, you know, cleanliness or moisturizing. And everywhere Kev went, he had this little medicine kit with lotions, potions, creams, and scents. And he'd come out looking beautiful. Nothing has changed. You're still looking beautiful every day.
That's funny.
But everywhere we'd go, he'd have this little black bag. And he'd be like, and we try to get in there. He's like, you can't go in there. You don't know.
Listen, I respect somebody that moisturizes. It's important.
Yeah, but hold on. Here's the thing that Johnny's failing to tell you. And, John, you're spot on so far. Yeah. But here's the thing. So, you know, guys that chirp, where you going with all those lotions and potions? Where are you going?
What
are you
going? Borrow some.
Yeah, exactly. All of a sudden, it'd be like, hey, man, my girlfriend's here. Can I get a little cologne? Like, seriously.
You're like the guy on the streets of New York. You open your jacket. It's like,
my jacket.
It's
like, what scents do you want? You want Obsession by Calvin Klein? CK1?
That's how he did it.
Jacquard Noir?
Oh, my God. He threw CK1.
Oh, yeah, of course.
There.
Of course.
That was the era.
Just to keep it, you know, dab it off cool water.
And so that's one memory for Kevin, always. The other one is, as we can see now, is he's got the helmet on. He's getting in game mode. Perspiration is the thing for Kev.
Well, we know that here.
And so.
Was the thing is the thing.
It's hot. Humid buildings, weeks he's playing, and occasionally he'd have cramping issues.
Yep.
Right.
And to combat those cramping issues, you needed your
Stimulstams.
Salt pills.
Yeah, electrolytes. You got to get him in.
Playing a game.
You got to get him in.
And we'd be like 7-8 minutes in the game, early, first period. And Weeksy, not even on a commercial break, it'd be a whistle. He'd be yelling on the bench, salt pills, salt pills. So the next commercial break, he'd come and they'd be sitting on the bench.
Oh, so
and he'd
good.
Chug them back. Yeah. And we'd be on the bench going, we're 7
What's up?
In.
Yeah, seriously, the game has started.
Oh, my God.
So I come by it naturally.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny?
I know where it comes from.
Let me tell you about that. What's funny is my parents for a long time, they're like, well, why don't you drink coconut water? Or try coconut water or whatever, because they're from the islands.
Can I just say, coconut water.
Here's what's crazy. No, but here's what's crazy. I'd be like, well, why would I do that? Next thing you know, I retire from playing. Now all these guys are drinking coconut water, pickle juice, Pedialyte.
Mustard.
Mustard on the bench the other day. So they were ahead of their time in knowing that. But a lot of athletes do that. They hydrate with coconut water. But I was laughing at my parents because I'm like, yeah, it's a Barbados thing.
You're like, whatever, mom and dad.
Yeah, sure,
now
sounds
it's
good.
You know,
yeah,
all the rage.
Sweet. Then it became all the rage.
Well, let's check in with Kevin Shattenkirk right now. He's down at Tampa.
Oh,
see what they got going.
Yeah, let's do it.
For the cramping issue down there.
Let me give it the Ryan Miller tilt, though.
There you go.
My gosh. Okay, here
Honestly,
we go. All right. We've been doing this thing this year on NHL Now Oct, where we kind of get into some stories when we have players on the show.
Sure.
Both of you guys, former players, obviously turned analysts. You guys played together in Tampa.
Yeah.
So I want some stories from you two about your short time. About your short time together with the Bolts.
If that's the case.
Well, for starters, Weeksy and I have known each other since we were probably 11 and 12 years old. We went to neighboring high schools in
Younger,
Toronto.
Bro. Don't jack up the math.
Wait, so your parents know each other?
Our dads are buddies. Every time I see Carl, he's like, hey, how's Ron? Yeah. They go to the Tim Hortons coffee shop.
And oh, my gosh. Of course they catch up at Tim Hortons.
Where have you been?
It's so Canadian.
Dads that grew up together watching their kids play. So they would cross paths, you know, growing up as minor hockey players. Then again, even in the NHL, we would cross paths when Kev's team would play in Toronto. My dad would be at the game or whatever it might be. So, yeah, we got a lot of history, Kevin and I. And then we were fortunate enough to play in Tampa together. So
we had a lot of fun.
Yeah, so I brought one of the Kevin. Every time I think of Kevin.
Oh, yes.
Jack, I love the tease that you I love what this leads to. What do we got here?
Weeksy was way ahead of his time. What did you carry everywhere you went?
The bag of beauty. It's here, too.
The bag of beauty.
I love it.
It's got some different components.
You still have
the
mask on. It's amazing.
This is way before anyone knew anything about, you know, cleanliness or moisturizing. And everywhere Kev went, he had this little medicine kit with lotions, potions, creams, and scents. And he'd come out looking beautiful. Nothing has changed. You're still looking beautiful every day.
That's funny.
But everywhere we'd go, he'd have this little black bag. And he'd be like, and we'd try to get in there. He's like, can't go in there. You don't know.
Listen, I respect somebody that moisturizes. It's important.
Yeah, but hold on. Here's the thing that Johnny's failing to tell you. And, John, you're spot on so far. Yeah. But here's the thing. So, you know, guys that chirp, where you going with all those lotions and potions? Where are you going?
What
are you
going? Borrow some.
Yeah, exactly. All of a sudden, it'd be like, hey, man, my girlfriend's here. Can I get a little cologne? Like, seriously.
You're like the guy on the streets of New York. You open your jacket. It's like,
my jacket.
It's
like, what scents do you want? You want Obsession by Calvin Klein? CK1?
That's how he did it.
Jacquard Noir?
Oh, my God. He threw CK1 out there.
Of course. Of course.
That was the era.
Just to keep it, you know, dab it off cool water.
And so that's one memory for Kevin, always. The other one is, as we can see now, he's got the helmet on. He's getting in game mode. Perspiration is the thing for Kev.
Well, we know that here.
And so
was the thing is the thing.
It's hot. Humid buildings, weeks he's playing, and occasionally he'd have cramping issues.
Yep.
Right.
And to combat those cramping issues, you needed your
Stimulstams.
Salt pills.
Yeah, electrolytes. You got to get them in.
Playing a game.
You got to get them in.
And we'd be like 7-8 minutes in the game, early, first period. And Weeksy, not even on a commercial break, it'd be a whistle. He'd be yelling on the bench, salt pills, salt pills. So the next commercial break, he'd come and they'd be sitting on the bench.
Oh, so
and he'd
good.
Chug them back. Yeah. And we'd be on the bench going, we're 7
What's up?
In.
Yeah, seriously, the game started.
Oh, my
God. So I come by it naturally.
Yeah.
But you know what's funny?
I know where it comes from.
Let me tell you about that. What's funny is my parents for a long time, they're like, well, why don't you drink coconut water? Or try coconut water or whatever, because they're from the islands.
Can I just say, coconut water.
Here's what's crazy. No, but here's what's crazy. I'd be like, well, why would I do that? Next thing you know, I retire from playing. Now all these guys are drinking coconut water, pickle juice, Pedialyte.
Mustard.
Mustard on the bench the other day. So they were ahead of their time in knowing that. But a lot of athletes do that. They hydrate with coconut water. But I was laughing at my parents because I'm like, yeah, it's a Barbados thing.
You're like, whatever, mom and dad.
Yeah, sure,
now
sounds
it's
good.
You know,
yeah,
all the rage.
Sweet. Then it became all the rage.
Well, let's check in with Kevin Shattenkirk right now. He's down at Tampa.
Oh,
see what they got going.
Yeah, let's do it.
Cramping issue down there.
Let me give it the Ryan Miller tilt, though.
There you go.
My gosh. Okay, here we go. Kevin Shattenkirk joining the show. Kevin, thanks for taking the time. We appreciate it. These guys are up here, you know, venting about salt pills. what's your take on the salt pill situation for K-Dub?
You know, I used to be on the Stimostam train just like you, Weeksy. So
I love it.
You gotta, especially in these warm climates, you gotta make sure that you're hydrated and getting ahead of the game.
That's a free dinner for you at Burns right there. Thanks to me.
Nice.
My favorite restaurant in the world.
I love it.
Thank you so much. So, Shatty, I mean, you, what a season. What a start it's been for you so far. Obviously, it was a difficult offseason, an emotional one, but you put it upon yourself. You believe in yourself. You know you've been a proven offensive guy and a highly skilled defenseman. What has it been like so far in terms of your own feel within your game? Because you look like you look like yourself. Mm-hmm. And what has it been like within the flow of that team that's so dynamic offensively?
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun, really. I think, like you said, with what happened this summer, there was plenty of inspiration and
plenty of stuff to fuel me. And I think really just getting into the season, getting to training camp, I wanted to get involved with this, with these guys as quickly as possible, make sure that I was studying how they play and just trying to fit in with what they have going here. So it's a highly offensive team, very skilled players and guys who think the game really well. And I feel like it's just a great fit for me and how I like to play hockey.
Yeah. Was that part of the consideration, Schatz, when you became a free agent? How quick, like, think of all the teams in the NHL that you could play well with. Tampa come first to mind. Was it that simple to try to get a contract down there?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we've kind of been in talks for the last few years too, and there's been some opportunities to come to Tampa Bay, and it just hasn't worked out. And finally this time around, it just felt right, obviously. And I think I also had to look at a chance for me to have a big bounce back season, putting myself in the best place to have success, and obviously looking at what they did last year and really just the last few years, how consistently good they've been in this league. I wanted to get back on a winning team and in a winning culture, and I know what that does for my game on an individual basis. So it's nice to be part of a group that wants to win night in and night out and has the ability to hopefully do something special this year.
Yeah, well, not only are you on a winning team, you're on a cup contending type of team out in Tampa. We all know how the season ended for them last year in the postseason. What is the mentality, or what was it like being a new guy on this team coming into a situation where last year really was a devastating end to their season? What is the mentality for this year?
Well, I think, no one's hidden from the fact, that they obviously had a disappointing finish to last year. And it's been great. I think the way that the guys have approached coming into this year and really gotten back to business and kind of said, you know what, we're not looking at last year and trying to defend our regular season record or the President's Trophy. We're going to go out there and it's going to be a brand new season. We're going to attack it and make sure that we're kind of making a new name for ourselves with the team we have here. So I feel like, there's a chip on their shoulder from what happened last year. And I feel like I kind of share that mentality with what happened with my situation this summer. And, we all have a goal here and obviously it's winning the Stanley Cup.
You know what, Shaddy, you've been a point, basically half a point per game guy your entire career. So nice to see you back on track, feeling good, being healthy too, which is a big part of it, and having a great fit down there so far in Tampa. But John and I were just talking about this, having played down there, we're just discussing it. It's a great place to play and maybe for a lot of the fans that don't have the opportunity to get down there and experience a game, maybe you could just talk about how awesome that atmosphere is and how much you've enjoyed it so far.
Yeah, I think it's like you said, Weeksy, I think when guys play there as opponents or when you get a chance to play for the Lightning, you think you're coming into a building that's going to be maybe a little dead and it won't be filled night in, night out. They have tremendous fans. It's such a great atmosphere. It doesn't matter if it's a Monday night or a Saturday night. The people there are really invested into the team. And I think a lot of it, has to be attributed to the ownership. I think Jeff Vinnick has done a really good job down there of making sure that the Lightning are part of the community. And because of that, people are coming to games and they want to support their team. So it really is, no pun intended, it's a pretty electric atmosphere in the arena. And I think it's obviously helps when you have a team that wins a lot and they go to playoffs and they have a chance to win it.
Shaddy, when you play every day with guys, you get a better appreciation maybe how good they might be. Has anyone stood out? You have so many incredible players. Has any one guy stood out on your own team, just how great they are that you might not have known now that you get to see them every day?
Yeah, like you said, I mean, with this group, there's obviously the few that everyone knows about. I would have to say someone who's really impressed me is Anthony Cirelli.
Yes.
A kid at his age, he plays a great two-way game, super responsible in the D zone, always in great position. He's wins a ton of his battles. I mean, little things that might not be visible to most people, but when you really take a step back and you look at the type of game that he has and realize that he's so young, I think his potential as a player is really, really high. And he's someone who's a big part of our team. And I think he embraces that. He's hungry to be a leader on this team at such a young age. And he drives the bus for us in a lot of ways.
Nice. High praise.
That's very high praise.
That's a great call because, watching him play,
Good player.
He is a very good, very underrated player since he was in Oshawa. Very good player.
I got to ask you about Braden Point. Returns to the lineup last night. Like, it's no, like, no big deal.
Hip surgery on line two?
Yeah. Oh, my goodness
he's
gracious.
He's not bad either.
Yeah.
Incredible.
He's, yeah, you know, again, another guy. I mean, you look at this team and you know, they have the superstars and the guys that everyone always talks about. But to think of, you know, the young guys that are coming up, you know, that are on this team, Sergachev, Chernak, obviously Braden Point, is the chemistry he has with Kucherov is fantastic. And I think, you know, he has the ability to stop and turn on a dime and skate out of trouble, a lot of trouble. And he just makes little plays that, you know, I guess one game in for me, it's been a joy to watch. And I'm looking forward to see, you know, what everyone here has been talking about for so long.
All right, well, listen, Kevin, always a pleasure to have you on the show. Your answers are always very thoughtful and engaged, and we appreciate that. And also, you deal with our nonsense, so thanks for your take on the salts as well. We appreciate it. Best of luck the rest of the way this season.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it. Always a good time.
Welcome back to NHL Now. It's Friday, which means it's time for our power rankings. Top five teams in the league. Weeksy, I'll go first to
do
give
that.
You a little bit of a guideline as the correct order as I put them up. One
through five. Really,
so,
though?
I'll go five. Colorado had a great start.
I like where you're starting.
Beat Boston last night at home. The big boys are all going really well.
Okay.
Not surprised to find them on there. Edmonton, listen, undefeated is undefeated. Comebacks, shootouts,
true.
Whatever
fair,
it takes.
Fair.
McDavid, Draisaitl, James Neal, seven goals, not a big deal. Boston
one more time.
Bruins, James Neal, not a big deal. Boston Bruins at three. On the road, most of all. I know they lost to Colorado, but they played some tough opponents. They look very good.
Yeah, I see it.
St. Louis, I'm actually a little surprised, able to bounce back and play so well post no Stanley Cup hangover for them. Jordan Binnington.
Real deal.
The man. I told
like
you guys.
Flash in the pan.
I told
and number
you.
One, Kevin Weeks' former squad, the Carolina Hurricanes.
Roddy
who
B.
have been great throughout their early part of the season.
Roddy
all
B.
their additions. Rod Brindamore looking really good.
Nice job, Johnny.
That's my top five.
Well done. Nice job.
Feel free to copy if you must.
No, no need to.
Like we're grade 10 high school again.
Similar.
Yeah, seriously.
Similar.
Come on, listen. Sir Johnny McDonald, here's the thing. The Avs at five.
I'm not a buffoon right
now. Yeah, exactly. No. Exactly. The Avs at, okay, we're on the same sheet of music.
Yep.
Blues I have at four right now, but I'm with you. No letdown. I spoke to Craig Berube. Love the way he has that team playing.
Mm-hmm.
Buffalo Sabres, though. For the Sabre fans, it's been a long road for the Sabres fans.
Yeah.
Rob Kruger, Jack Eichel, Olofsson has been incredible,
power
by the way.
Power play has been power off play. The charts
53.3% right
can
now.
Can those
that
goalies
good?
Keep it up?
Yeah.
They didn't last
as
year.
Long as they play well defensively the way they are now. So I like what I'm seeing. Edmonton Oilers, hey, my parents always say, give Jack his jacket or Jackie her dress. And that's
okay.
it. Right?
Fair.
To be fair, like the Oilers are playing great. I'll see them tomorrow at 1. I'll be at the Garden watching the game. Carolina Hurricanes, former squad. Hey, listen, there's no drop off. They're playing the exact same way they did last year.
Dougie Hamilton showing
me how
the
to.
Whole game.
Teach me how to.
I will. After
oh, my gosh, yeah. please do
yeah,
it.
Teach me how to
please
Dougie
teach
Hamilton.
Me how to Dougie.
Hold on one
teach
sec,
me.
Though. Let's get somebody in here. What were you just saying about Tanks?
Oh, Tangs.
Tangs, you watching?
He was saying hello, like in our last thing. I was just wondering if they had our show out in Iowa where he's at right now.
Yeah.
Oh, see, now they're going to get mad at you over there.
Yeah, like what?
I've never been
but,
to Iowa.
Hang on. I do have one question, though. I have
could
one question.
Could be on
question.
The bus. That's right. Yes.
I have one question about the power rankings. I actually asked you this already, Johnny, but I want to get your take.
Uh-huh.
A dub.
Tell me.
Canes undefeated, Oilers undefeated, Avs undefeated.
Yep.
Why are the Canes the best of those three?
The Canes
so
are the hardest, most consistent, hardest working team. Shift to shift, their ability to get shot differential, and their defense. I think their defense is arguably the best young defensive core in the league.
Pesci, Slavin, Hamilton, Gardner, Edmondson.
Hayden Fleury slotted as a five.
He's going to be something pretty
he's
good.
He's going to be nice.
And I think their coach, he's got it figured out. Whatever Rod Brindamore is doing is working with that group.
To say the very least. Good job, guys. Normally I come
thank
in
you.
Hot, but I'm like, hey, this is pretty good.
Thank you. Thanks
just
so
give
much.
Me more of the
all
goods.
Right. Okay.
All right.
Here's Fowler. Score! He dangled around a defender and picked the top corner. What a play and what a finish by Cam Fowler. It's perfect.
Now the Rangers look to go 2-on-1. Here's Zibanejad with Kako. Zibanejad pulls back and scores! Mika Zibanejad with the hat trick! A shorthanded goal and it's 3-1 Rangers!
What a show he is putting on. What an unbelievable show Mika Zibanejad, and it's early
in this game.
Here's a steal, Cirelli. He's in the clear. Feeding it. Palat shoots. Save Bobrovsky.
Palat gets a really good shot. He does the right thing. He tries to get it elevated. But how about that reactionary save by Bobrovsky coming back?
Hoffman poked it along to Connolly, who then moves it to the point. Ekblad's quick shot, score! Deflected in! It's Mike Hoffman! And it's a home opener hat trick!
How hot is Mike Hoffman? And the Hats and the Rats come streaming out onto the ice. Unbelievable hand-eye coordination of Mike Hoffman.
Lawton moves it ahead. Konechny in. Konechny drags it backhand, score! What a goal! Travis Konechny, and it's 3-1 Philadelphia.
Toe tuck and backhanded shelf. Are you kidding me?
I love this because he does it on two-time Norris Trophy winner Duncan Keith. That was absolutely smooth. What a play by Konechny.
Neal along with Yurchuk. Tomas Yurchuk stops up, gives it to Neal. Quick shot, he scores!
Give him four goals. Real deal, James Neal.
The Oilers have a 5-1 lead. What a night for number 18.
First thing we learned is to keep your head up in hockey, and that's a good piece of advice. Oh, did you see that? You won't see a better stop than that. That's the save of the night. It might be one of the saves of the year. Devin Dubnyk with a miraculous stop.
Back to Gaudreau as they get set up now on the 6-on-5. Anderson shoots, stopped by Campbell. Rebound, Tkachuk scores!
What a night for Matthew Tkachuk.
How many times does Tkachuk get his stick on the puck before it ends up in behind? The hand-eye coordination, that is impressive.
Larkin won it. Hronek across Mantha, scores! Four goals!
Anthony Mantha, 4. The Dallas Stars, 3. 19:06, the time of the goal from Hronek and Larkin. Mantha, his 4th. And 5th of the season.
Bouncing puck. Here's Coleman. Got a shot away. He scored! Oh my goodness, Blake Coleman!
Oh my! What an individual one-handed effort from Blake Coleman.
The old alley-oop play. He gets a little bit of leverage. The puck's rolling. He reaches in. He's got the puck on the heel of his stick. And this is the key. It's on the heel of his stick. Twist of the stick, and it just rolls from heel to toe, and the snap. Those are things you practice. Yeah. Never, not in a game, right. Though.
No. Very cool.